For those of you who haven't been at the programs earlier on today, my name's Ruth McDougall. I'm the Curator of Pacific Art here at the Queensland Art Gallery, Gallery of Modern Art. And it's my very great pleasure today to be introducing Florence Jaukae-Kamel, who is an artist whose work we do have in the collection. You see behind the very beautiful Calibobble billum dress, which we acquired in 2011. Florence is an absolute inspiration in terms of her support of billum and her development of platforms for the exploration of that through contemporary creative expression, and also for her support for women in the Eastern Highlands and other areas throughout PNG to develop markets for their billum ware. I'd also like to acknowledge and bring forward Ruth Chulai, who has worked extensively with Florence and also been equally instrumental in the promotion of billum and billum ware internationally through her work through Pacific Islands Trade and Invest. And fantastic that we're actually standing in a space in which we have both Florence's work and also the beautiful work of Wendy Chulai and Ruth's sister behind you today. So I guess we might start. Florence, can you just tell us a little bit about how you came to work with billum?
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Florence, as Wendy has already introduced me. I'm from Goroka in the Netherlands province. And it's been 14 years that I've taken the journey with billum. And my inspiration started from a singing encyclopedia, where after my children were looking at it to do their homework, and I was inspired by the carpet snake with the scale and the small green leather tape. So that was where my inspiration started and where my first billum dress started from, and it all came out to be here.
And Florence, can you tell us a little bit about the contemporary development of innovation within billum ware since you began working with it? I believe you it is a practice that you learned as a child, that you've inherited in a way, and can you just talk about that development for you to, the more contemporary exploration?
Billum initially is something that women carry food and babies in it. It's a skill, an ancient skill that was and is passed down from our ancestors' mothers. And it's like the grandmothers pass it on to the mothers, and then the mothers pass it on to the children, especially the girls. And it's a skill that is currently all over Papua New Guinea. About 80% of the women can weave billums in Papua New Guinea. And as I have already said, billum is something that we carry baby and food stuff in it. But the idea of making it into something that one can wear wearable art is a different approach that I've taken with myself and with women, with the support of my women back in Goroka in Eastern Islands. And we've gone back down as far as Mene, Morobe, and some parts of the other islands provinces.
Florence, can I just ask a little question? How old were you when you started to make billum? Can you remember?
I was a little girl. Yeah. But in the past, it's something where when the mother is weaving the billum, like when my mother was weaving the billum, I'll be next to her, trying to pull the strings off of her, trying to do it to myself, and then she'll be like, oh, we want to do it. And then she'll be pushing me away, and then I'll keep crying and wanting to do it too, until she'll give up, and then she'll cut the string out and then join it together, make it like a circle kind of thing. And then in Goroka language we call it sanakuma. So it's something where she'll try to get me to get busy into this sanakuma. It's like we make other stuff like fire or with our lanterns to it anyway. So back in Goroka. So that was basically how I started doing that. But then I didn't want to do that. I wanted to do the actual billum myself. So I was taught by my mother to start twisting it. So she tells me, like, you don't have to do the billum if you can't twist. So first thing you need to do is twist first. And if you are confident with twisting, that's when you can read. So that was where it all started. But then, you know, we all went to school and all this, and the idea just went to the back. It all was there in the back. But then when I came out and saw the carpet snake again, like when I was, I mean, some years ago, so I decided to read the billum again and take up the challenge and take it on to present.
And Florence, what about the beginnings of your work with Jaukae billum products and your work with other billum weavers throughout both in the Eastern Highlands and also down in the Dang and other areas of the PNG?
Well, when I started doing the billum, and when I started doing the first billum dress that I was wearing with the support of my women in the community, I then, at the time, I was an elected councillor, the only female elected councillor at the time for rural and rural level government, and I was the councillor for Kamala and Nifra. And I had about 18,000 people that I look after within my ward area, and during the time, our government, our territorial government, each councillor is funded 5,000 public in Kina, which is not enough to look after 18,000 people. So for me, I had to try to think about other things to support my community and my people. So I tried to work with water, you know, water supply or electricity, which I did. But then in the end, it seemed to be beneficial to only one little community because it's 5,000 Kina, while the other side was like not benefiting from my services. So I had to go back to my local level council manager, Ismail Salak, and I had to ask him to give me support to do billum. And he just gave me this laugh and he said, Florence, you're doing billum dresses and everybody's going to say it's conflict of interest because you're doing billum dresses. And I said, I don't care, I'm going to stand up and take this challenge, so just give me the money. So he gave me 3,000 Papua New Guinea Kina, which wasn't enough, but I just did that. So I started going over and taking the women and encouraging them to make billum, support them and treat them and help them in a little bit to try and do billums. And then the other challenge I had was marketing. Where will we market the billums? Unfortunately, my term as a councilman caught up with me in 2007. So somebody else won the election. And then I had already given hope to the women that there was somewhere we could benefit from with the billum. So when the women, when I lost from the election, I had to stand for the women because there were a number of women who were already following me and having hope with me. So without the support of the government until the present, I just had to stand up for the women, and that's how it was that brought me this far.
Florence, can you share with us your experience of the first time you were with women, particularly the Western Highlands Marlow?
The first time I was with women, just as everybody, there were two kind of people in the community. One was saying, like, as people saying, wow. I'm not used to saying wow. Some people were saying, wow, look at that, she looks beautiful. We like it. We wanna wear them. And the others were like, what does she think she is? Wearing something that we used to carry bags and food stuff. So people who were traditionally minded, they were going against me. They think that I was say an idiot or a foolish woman trying to wear something that they carry big and food stuff in. But I had to twist the mind around. I said, I don't care what you think, I'm gonna wear it. So the first time I wore the Hagen apron, similar to this one. The first time I wore it, it is an apron that is confined to Western Islands male dancers only. And you are not, I mean, being a woman and I'm from the Eastern Islands, I had to cross Chibu province and Jiwaka, go up to Western Islands and take the male apron, bring it down to Eastern Islands, and I did a dress out of it. And the first time I wore the dress out from the male apron, there was a prominent Western Islander who just stood there and looked at me like that and said, Florence, that's my malo. And I said, yes, it's your malo. I'm making a little dress out of it. So it was like, they didn't know what to do because I was already breaking the traditional barrier that was between Western Island and the Eastern Island, and being a woman in Eastern Islands, crossing over, taking the male apron from Western Islands and then making it into my dress was something someone wasn't thinking about that I did. So I'm proud I wore it.
Florence, can you tell us about some of the designs of these dresses? They all have very, very detailed
difference between making a billum dress and a billum, getting the idea of telling a story out of it, was after Marketing Place when I was in Sydney, and there was a famous artist who was there. He's like fine painting kind of artist. And he was there, and he saw me there for Marketing Place too, and he just stood up and he said, "Hey, Florence, why are you here? Like, I see billum is not an artwork. Why are you here? Why are you doing this?" And I felt offended, and I felt so bad because he was a recognized Papua New Guinean artist, and he has his reputation. And for me, like, just a simple woman from the village and a billum weaver, and someone just say that to me was like, am I going the right way? Am I doing the right thing? So I was, I came home that night. I was very worried with me, and I was with Miss Chola in the house. We were there, and I couldn't talk. And there was the late Martin Morobuna. He was there with me, and we were sharing the same house together with Miss Chola. And when we were there, he got up and he said, "Florence, don't feel bad about it. You have to go back and come back and prove to them that you can do billum as an art. And you can do it. It's not all about weaving a billum bag and carrying babies and food stuff in it, or all about wearing it. You need to put your energy into the dress." So that was when he inspired me, and I started creating dresses. So the first dresses that I did was a dress that I created telling the personal story about my lifestyle and all this. So it's in a personal collection. And then from there I started doing all this, and well, as you said, the centipede is a very interesting dress that I did. It's just simple, but I was in Kakar Island, I was doing some work, and being more traditionally, I'm influenced by my grandparents, so being more traditionally a follower of, you know, traditional custom and all this, I was in Kakar Island, and then every day for 3 days I've been seeing like 10 to 20 centipedes crossing my path. Every time they were crossing my path, going to and fro, and then like my grandfather and my grandmother used to tell me, whenever you see a snake or you see something like that crossing your path, that means that's bad luck and you're gonna be in trouble. So like when I was in Kakar, I saw the centipede doing that for 3 days. So I had to run over to the Kakar station, bought the black and orange robe, similar to the centipede. And then I created the centipede snake. So I just started it, and then I dropped it on the ground. And then when the centipede walked over and tried to cross, I allowed it to jump over my billum. And I told the centipede, if you're here for good luck, then thank you. But if you're here for bad luck, then I'm tying your leg. I'm looping it up now, so you're not gonna do anything to me. So it's more like a traditional belief kind of thing. So here is the secular ring. Here is the head of the centipede. Then it goes out, so it goes out. So these are the heads. So this is the mama centipede. These are the heads, and this is how the journey and that the centipede goes. So it travels, and the black and the yellow is the color of the centipede. And after I did it, I never saw any centipede until I left Kakar.
Well, we have time.
Black bedding is an inspiration that I took when I was in Auckland with doing a presentation with Yvonne from Australian Museum. We're co-presenting at the Art Symposium in Auckland. And Imelda, she was doing a presentation about South Sea Islanders and taken over to Queensland and working around the Queensland, you know, become sugar farmers. So I just sat there, when she was doing the presentation, I just sat there and I was really crying out. I was just sitting there and I had tears coming down on me. So I decided to go and do something about that. So I got inspired by Imelda. So the black is the color of the people from South Sea. The shells represent the island that they were from. So they were from the island, so, you know, like most people saying the Pacific is all about shells and coconuts and all this, so that's shells represent them. Then the color white is the colored people that went there and took the South Sea Islanders into Queensland to work the sugar farm. So So they went into different places and started picking out people and taking them in. So I had it patched all around. And then how you've seen the women, the young woman who was wearing it, she had it over her head. So they had the beauty and they had everything in them, but they couldn't put it out because they were taken away from the place. So they were covered in darkness. And the furthest out there, it talks about the beauty that is in them, but they couldn't show it to them all the time. They were working the farm, working the sugar farm. So that's the inspiration that I took from Imelda in Auckland. This is rugby league. It's NRL. What's NRL? Yeah, it's NRL. And when you talk about rugby league in Papua New Guinea, everybody, people can die over rugby league. And Australians are Papua New Guinean gods when it's to do with rugby league. Everybody in Papua New Guinea, especially I'll talk about my town, Eastern Islander, and my town, Moroka, everybody, when it's like, when it's the first, second, or the tenth state of origin, the town, in the morning, the first load of trucks, they come into the town and then they just go and buy cartons and cartons of beer and food like lamb flaps, cockroach, whatever. They just buy it and then they go back to the village. When they go to the village, they just go and cook. And as soon as the state of origin comes on, there's no one walking, no noise, no nothing. And so, so we have what has happened is they kind of like they get money and they go into two groups, Queensland, New South Wales, and then they started supporting. And at the end of the rugby game, there's always someone dying for the love of NRL, for the love of state of origin. There's always someone dying, or there's always a woman that has a broken eye, or that is abused because of rugby league. Or there's always TV screens that are broken. And I had to do this because everybody in the town were going around with it. And I mean, if you ask someone from Eastern Islands, we are victims of state of origin. So this is the pom pom girl. This is the New South Queensland supporter. So she's got the pom pom. She's supporting and cheering Air Queensland team. This is the New South Wales. And New South Wales pom pom girl is cheering for the team. This is state of origin. So there's two teams, Maroons and Blues, they play the state of origin. This is the state of origin. Blues is the Blues as in New South Wales. At the back is Maroons as Queenslanders. You will notice that it's got a little bit of red underneath and there's flowers here. So when you look at the dress, when they play, it's the two teams, the Maroons and the Blues, they go together and they play. When they play, at least someone dies. Either they win or they lose, one team will win. But at the end, there's always blood spilling off. So, the red underneath is the blood. And when it comes to someone dying, we put flowers. So these are the flowers. So, it talks about what in reality is happening in my town. And it's all Papua New Guinea, but I'm talking about my town, specifically my town, because I witness all this. So either way, someone dies because of rugby league. So it's Australians, you're diehard.
Okay, we might just have a story about one more dress, because it's a particularly strong one. Can you tell us a little bit about the Hanuman?
Lifestyle of people, the Hanuapada people in Bokosbi, their land is the red, it's the blood of the people of Hanuapada. The gray is the color of the soil or the land that they have. So he talks about the lifestyle of people out there. If you go down to the big village, I'm sure some of you Papua New Guineans here have gone down there, some of the other side will know, but if you go down there, you will notice that every house has a cemetery at the doorstep. And where will they bury their dead? They're burying their dead right at the doorstep again, because there is no land for them. Traditionally, my grandparents, they told me that you are not allowed to bury your dead at your doorstep, because when you bury your dead at the doorstep, someone else will die or follow you, and you know, it's more like the spiritual. They will call you to come and go with them. But for the Anuapada people, mostly it's taken over. Development has taken over the land. Where they go and fish, it's polluted. Where they go and hunt, there's nothing more. There's only development, big buildings. People are moving into Port Moresby and taking over the land. So when you look at it, the house, I'm going to start from the bottom and go up. Down here is the house. It talks about living. So the name of the dress is Anuapada, people living with the dead. So this is the house where all the people that are alive are living in. That's a tree. And that tree talks of, there'll be a lot of mango trees and Yeah, so mango trees and all this, that are leftovers from the gardens that once the ancestors were planting. So these are the remains of their garden. So in the house, I mean, in the village, Anuapada village, you have people living there, but they always have big mango trees next to their house. Why? Because it used to be their garden. And that is the remain of their garden, because our ancestors in the past, they were hunters and gatherers. So this is the remain of the gardening that they had. Then here is the cemetery, and it talks about the dead people. So for the people of Anuapada and Port Moresby, whether they like it or not, when they die, they bury their dead right at the doorstep. So when they wake up in the morning, they open the door and they step on the cemetery again and they go out. When they come back, they step on the cemetery and go inside the house. Traditionally, it's wrong. The dead should be at their own place and the living should be at their own place. But this is Port Moresby. That's what's happening to them. Their land has been taken away by Papua New Guinea. Papua New Guinea is developing. The National Capital District is developing on their land. So rightfully, their land has been taken away. Then when you look up here, there's another cemetery here. And you see this one, that's the road that is going through the cemetery. So if you go to the runabout at Badiagua, and when you look straight to the Napanapa, the refinery that is there, when you look straight there, you will see the big old Bulldozer models. Yeah, the road equipment. They are there, and they are fixing the road, making roads over there. And tell you what, they had to run the roads all over the old cemeteries that were once belonging to the ancestors there. So they just ran over it. So it talks about that. So they didn't care who these people were, because they just ran the road over the cemetery, trying to develop the place. So it's for development again. And up here I have all these houses that goes around here, and it talks about development. It's for the love of development. So they didn't care what happens to the people there. It's what's there. So when I have this shawl that is attached to it, sell money, taboo, and it's got red string that made it together with it. And it's for the love of money. The shawl represents the money, and blood is, the red is the blood. So either way, it's for the love of that. So the head, it's like, they pretend to wear good hands and they pretend to be good people, but what's inside them, the pain that is inside them, they've lost their culture, they've lost their tradition, they've lost what belongs to them. And that has been through development. So that's Anuapada, people living with the dead.
Okay, will everyone